Hi, I'm Pastor Leighton with Church of the Highlands in San Bruno, California, and welcome to our online services for Sunday, October 4th of 2020. Today, we're also providing drive-in services at 9 and 11 and services in the sanctuary at 8 and 10. We're so glad to be able to gather together again and worship the Lord. Later in the service today, we'll be providing a time of communion led by Pastor John. So if you'd like to prepare those elements, that would be great. And then our sermon today should be a source of encouragement to us all. It's about the importance of unity. So welcome to Church of the Highlands today.
Sing it together. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Here we go.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder?
Amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would.
Thank you, Lord God, for all that you've done for us, all that you continue to do. We look to you, God, for everything that we need, everything.
Hallelujah.
Lord, we just thank you. We come before you thanking you, God, because you know our every need, even before we whisper it, even before we think it, God. You know exactly the situations we are going through, Lord, and we know that you are bigger than every single circumstance, every single situation, God, every single thing that is happening this year, God. We pray, Lord, God, that you continue to bless this congregation. You continue, God, to worship and minister to your people. We are your sons and daughters, God, and we just thank you, Lord, because you look out for us. You look out for creation, for nature, for the birds, Lord. We have nothing to fear. We have nothing to worry about because we know, Lord, that you are our hope. You are our salvation. And we can put all our trust in you. And we know, God, that you will follow through on your plans and you will lead us into the path of righteousness. We thank you, God, because you are faithful and true and you are completing your promises each and every day to each and every one of us. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Well, so glad that you're with us this weekend here at Church of the Highlands. Glad that you've joined us for worship. Just a couple of things that we want to remind you of before we get into this weekend's message. It's really easy to connect with us here at Highlands in San Bruno through our website at highlands.us, also through the Highlands app and on Facebook and Instagram. So you want to check us out if you haven't already checked us out on those various platforms. Just a reminder that fall groups and special interest classes are still forming. So if you are not already involved in a small group, we'd love to get you connected into one. They're online at this point, but we'd still love to have you connect in with us. You can get onto our highlands.us website. There is a complete list of all of the classes and groups and special interest groups that are happening this fall. And just a reminder, over the last few weeks, we've been telling you about the start of our Bible study fellowship groups here at Church of the Highlands. We've had the privilege of sponsoring both a men's and a women's BSF group for the last number of years. And even though they have already begun their study in Genesis, it's not too late for you to be able to join those classes. You can find out how to do that. Sign up through bsfinternational.org, bsfinternational.org. And then certainly we want to know here at Highlands, especially during this unusual time of sheltering in place and social distancing, how we can help. If there are ways that we can help you, maybe you need prayer, we'd love to come alongside you and pray for you and with you. If those in your family need prayer, we'd love to be able to just to partner with you in prayer. Each day we have one of our pastors who brings a devotional, a brief devotional on our website, so you can check that out right on the homepage. And then there's also a button that you can click that will take you to additional resources. Maybe you just need to be resourced in a slightly different way this year with this situation. We'd love to be able to connect in with you and resource you in whatever way that we can help. And then just again, we just want to say thank you to all of our great Highlands family who continues to pour out their support in prayers, in notes and cards, and certainly in continued giving. It's allowing us to reach out in many, many ways into our community here in the San Francisco Bay Area and also around the world in many different spots. So thank you, Highlands. Just so appreciate your faithfulness, your prayers, and your continued giving.
Hi, I'm Pastor Leighton from Church of the Highlands in San Bruno, and this is Sunday, October 4th of 2020. Let's pray together, shall we? Lord, we're so thankful that we can call upon you and that we can go to your word and that we can receive guidance and encouragement during these difficult days. Lord, we are desperately in need of guidance and encouragement. Lord, thank you for your word. May you be our teacher this day, and may you transform the way we think, the way we speak, the way we act, as your spirit and your word is at work within us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I'd like to invite you to turn your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 4, because we're going to talk today about the importance of unity. And when we were together last, I mentioned that Christianity is unique, it's special. There's no other belief system like it in the world, nothing even close. And it's been said that the gospel of Jesus is encapsulated in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." For God so loved the world. Love, it's one of the things that is unique about Christianity. God loved us, and in response to that, we love Him because He first loved us. And then we are called to love each other. We are called to love our brothers and sisters in Christ. We are called to love our neighbor as ourselves, and we're even called to love our enemies and pray for those who despitefully use us. Now, we're all aware that this is an election year and these are divisive times. And it would seem that everyone has a strong opinion about which party or candidate is our Savior. For a Christian, there is only one Savior, only one true Savior, and that is Jesus Christ. He doesn't appear on the ballots, but He is our Savior. Jesus Christ has saved us from our sin. He is preparing an eternal kingdom where there's going to be no swamp to drain. And the swamp dwellers aren't going to be there because His kingdom is a place that is filled with righteousness and peace and joy. There's going to be no looting in heaven because there's no thieves in heaven. And nothing's going to rust because there's no corruption. So hypothetically, you could park a Ferrari in the worst part of heaven, unlocked with the keys on the dash, and come back 10,000 years later and still be there. Heaven's going to be a place that's filled with righteousness, peace, and joy. And God's kingdom of heaven is the eternal hope of Christians. It's the place that we look forward to being with Him for all eternity. This is our home. It's not this world. We're just passing through this world. Our home is with Christ forever. Now, does that mean that Christians should vote? And the answer is yes, we should, because we're called to represent Christ's kingdom in this world. Should a Christian vote Christian values? And the answer is yes, because it's an opportunity to be the salt of the earth and slow decay. And we should engage in conversations about current events and share helpful information that we've had, because people, quite frankly, are not getting a lot of good and helpful information from the various news medias. But we should not engage in passionate, hate-filled arguments that accomplish little except to injure relationships. We should not do that. These are divisive times, and we must not allow the church to be invaded by hatred and divisions. We must protect the unity of the church. Now, years ago, I was with some pastors, the experience of which covered multiple decades, and what they found is that there was a trend where people would come to church not for what they could give or contribute, but for what they could get, what pleased them. And someone has described them as church shoppers and hoppers. They often attend multiple churches because they like the preaching at one and the worship at another and something else. But they never connect as a member. And the result is that neither they nor the church that God has called them to receive the full blessing of what God intended. And according to Barna Research, this trend is increasing under COVID-19. So in the weeks to come, as we prepare to return to church, I think it's important to be reminded of the importance of a believer's connection with the local church and the fact that we need to come together in unity. Ephesians chapter 4, beginning at verse 1, says, "As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received." Well, that's good. How do we do that? The answer is found in verse 2. "Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love." Towards what goal? Verse 3. "Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace." Why? Verses 4 through 6. "There's one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all." So let's study this passage verse by verse. It begins, "As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received." And you know, the Apostle Paul, we read, we find that he is by nature a busy, traveling evangelist. He loved going from one city to the next, telling people about Jesus. And so sitting in a prison must have been a great inconvenience to him. But that has been a great blessing to millions of believers down through the centuries, because much of what Paul wrote in his contribution to the New Testament, he wrote as a prisoner for the Lord. The calling is what is described in the first three chapters of Ephesians, and I hope that we'll be able to study that as a church in the months to come. And a life that is worthy is described in the next verse. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Now, have you noticed that some of the descriptions in verse 2 are also found in Paul's description of godly love found in 1 Corinthians chapter 13? So if I could paraphrase this part of Ephesians chapter 4 to go something like this: love each other to protect the unity of the Spirit. Now, the verse contains four characteristics of a person who is worthy of the calling, and notice that all four of these characteristics are manifested in our relationships with each other. We are humble in our relationships with each other. We are gentle in our relationships with each other. We're patient in our relationships with each other. And of course, we can't bear with another, with one another, if there ain't another, if we're alone. And so believers make up the church, the body of Christ. And so we must be together. We need to serve together. We need to worship together. And these four characteristics create and maintain a smooth relationship between believers. Now, the first of the characteristics is humility. And someone has said that humility is the grace that when you know you have it, you have lost it. That is, if you think you're humble, then you're most likely not. Humility means putting Christ first, others second, and yourself last. It means knowing, accepting, and being ourselves all to the glory of God. It means not thinking either more highly or less highly of ourselves than we ought to. Humility is not groveling. Now, humility is an attitude, and the gentleness is the action that comes from it. Gentle people don't attempt to grab positions of importance or power. Gentle people accept God's dealing with them without resisting. Gentle people are considerate of others. And if everyone in a church had these characteristics of humility and gentleness, then conflicts would disappear. The third characteristic is patience, also translated long-suffering. It conveys the quality of handling another person's faults and failures with gentleness and refusing to avenge. The fact is that none of us are ever going to be perfect as long as we're here on earth, and so believers must learn to be patient with one another despite our facts. And bearing with one another in love is the action side of patience, which is the attitude. It emphasizes a willingness to forgive and empathize with the other person. And to show patience with love should be the guiding principle for everything we do as believers. Now, bearing with one another presupposes that sometimes it's going to be a burden. It's going to require an effort. And so believers must be ready to carry that burden. Verse 3, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Unity of the Spirit cannot be created by the church or manufactured by believers. It's not called the unity of the church or the unity of the believers. It's called the unity of the Spirit, or unity from the Spirit. It comes from God the Holy Spirit. And true unity among believers is only possible when the Holy Spirit is at work within their lives. So it's the Holy Spirit that originates and sustains unity among believers. As believers, our responsibility is not to create unity, but to keep or protect it. It says, make every effort, and that translates a word that means to make haste, and it describes zeal and diligence, that we must be zealous and diligent about keeping, about protecting the unity of the Spirit. And it's in the present participle, meaning it's a continuous action. We must always and continually be active protecting the unity of the Spirit. And the word contains the idea of working towards something that's difficult. And the Apostle Paul knew that maintaining unity among believers was going to be hard work and was going to take diligence, because there are many schemes designed to tear believers apart. Paul notes some of them in the Scriptures. He talks about false teachers that would arise even from within the church and lead many astray. And that happened then, it happens today. He talked about persecution that would intimidate the church and scatter the church. And so church unity has been under attack from the very beginning, and it comes in various forms. One of the forms the Apostle Paul had to address right in chapter 1 of his letter to the Corinthian church. He says, I appeal to you, brothers, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree with one another, so that there may be no divisions among you, and that you may be perfectly united in mind and thought. My brothers, some from Chloe's household have informed me that there are quarrels among you. And what I mean is this: one of you says, I follow Paul. Another, I follow Apollos. Another, I follow Cephas, or Peter. And still another, I follow Christ. Is Christ divided? You know, there's always been a tendency in churches to divide into personality cults, even from the very beginning. Some of those early Corinthian believers said, hey, I like Peter. And others said, well, I like Paul. Now, when you read through the gospel accounts about the Apostle Peter, he seemed like a man that was driven by passion and oftentimes spoke before he thought. And then when you read about the writings of the Apostle Paul, you're introduced to a brilliantly educated mind. And with what little we know about Apollos, it's suggested that he was an exceptionally gifted orator whose theology was polished by the husband and wife team of Aquila and Priscilla. And each of these church leaders was was distinct in their background and their personality and their communication styles, but all were important to the church. Differences in styles is all important to the church. And so we must be alert lest the church, which is the body of Christ, be divided. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized into the name of Paul? So Paul asks, is Christ divided? In just a few verses, he says that there's one Christ. Christ is not divided. And then Paul confronts his own fan club. He says, was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized into the name of Paul? Obviously not. The church is not about Paul or Peter or Cephas or Pastor so-and-so. It's about Christ. Christ is the center of our attention. He is the center of our affection. We do what we do to please Christ, not Peter, not Paul, not Pastor so-and-so. We, the church, are Christ's hands, His feet, His mouth, commissioned to continue His ministry. And then look at verses 4 through 6. It says, there's one body and one spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. One God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. Did you notice how many times the word one is found in these few verses? It's seven times. And everything that relates to salvation, whether it's the church, the kingdom of God, it's all based on this concept of unity. And so to emphasize the unity of the Spirit, Paul describes the features of oneness in the Christian doctrine and life. But also notice that verse 4 focuses on the Holy Spirit, verse 5 focuses on Christ Jesus, and verse 6 focuses on God the Father. Let's look at verse 4. There is one body and one Spirit. There is one body, regardless of all that can divide believers, racial background, social status, gender, to name just a few. All true Christians belong to the one true body through the Holy Spirit. And the body that's being spoken of here is the body of Christ, which is the true church made up of believers. There's no Gentile church and a Jewish church. There's no Hispanic church and a Filipino church. There's only one church. There's only one body of Christ, which is made up of all believers from all of the nations and all of the ages. Every true believer is a part of the body of Christ. And Christ prayed for unity among His believers in John chapter 17. Listen to what Jesus prayed. He prayed, Holy Father, protect them by the power of Your name, the name You gave Me, so that they may be one as We are one. My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in Me through their message, that's us, that all of them may be one, Father, just as You are in Me and I am in You. May they also be in us. Why? So that the world may believe that You have sent Me. May they be brought to complete unity, to let the world know that You sent Me and have loved them even as You have loved Me. Not once, but twice, Jesus tells me why unity is so, so important. And it's important because it's through our unity that the world will know that Jesus was the Savior sent from God. Unity is exceptionally important to God. It's important for the work of the church. Unity produces peace, and this world is filled with very little unity and very little peace. You don't find it between nations, in businesses, and precious few times you'll even find it in homes. But when the world looks on a group of people who've gathered together from all kinds of walks of life and cultural backgrounds and socioeconomic differences and educational accomplishments, generations that span decades, people who live in godly love and unity and peace, then the world knows that that's not natural. It's not normal. And they're right. It's supernatural. It's the work of God. It's the work of God's Holy Spirit. And so it's the work of God, the Holy Spirit, to create unity, and it's the responsibility of every believer to keep or protect that unity. He continues, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. The one Spirit is the guarantee of our inheritance. That inheritance includes the hope to which we are called. The hope to which we are called includes eternal life in God's kingdom. As Christians, our hope is not in this world. It's passing away. Our hope is in Christ and in the inheritance we receive as children of God through Christ. And then he continues on in verse 5. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. And so this verse focuses on Christ. There's only one Christ. There's only one Lord. He is Christ Jesus. And there's only one faith. And that speaks of the body of truth that is described as the Apostles' Doctrine and sometimes as the Apostles' Creed. You know, some Christians, not all Christians agree on secondary matters of the Christian doctrine, but we all agree on the fundamental foundations of the Christian faith. And the Apostle Paul here is quite concerned that Christians not break the unity of the Spirit by agreeing with false doctrine. And the Apostle John also issues a similar warning as well. What they're saying is the church, the local church, cannot believe in false doctrine or peace at any price, that God's wisdom is first pure, then peaceable. Our doctrine needs to be pure, and it's from pure doctrine then that we enjoy true peace. And it must be said that purity of doctrine by itself does not produce spiritual unity. I know of many churches that have very excellent doctrine, but they are not places you find Christian love. And Paul joins the two, speaking the truth in love. John describes Jesus in the first verses of the Gospel of John as being full of grace and truth, not once, but twice. We want to be like Jesus, so we want to be full of grace and truth. What Jesus did is he spoke the truth graciously. And so we want to speak the truth graciously. And whenever people believe in Jesus Christ as their Savior and Lord, that is by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, that is the faith that saves. There's only one way to God, and that is through Christ. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. It's that one faith in Christ that binds us together. And then look at verse 6. One God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. This verse is magnificent for us at a time like this. This verse is focusing on God the Father. It says there's only one God. There's only one God. And it says of him that he is Father of all, meaning that he is the creator of everything. And then it says that God is above or over all, that he is the ruler, he is supreme over all of his creation. And then God is through all, that he is present and active in creation, holding it together. And then he is in all. Now, it's important for us to understand that Paul is not here teaching pantheism, that God is in everything so we can worship everything. And he's not teaching universalism, that since God is the Father of all, everything will be saved. But what he's talking about is God being omnipotent, omnipresent, and omniscient, ruling over creation. Now, those are big words, but they're important words for us to understand because we're going to find encouragement in them. God is omnipotent. Omnipotent means he is all-powerful. That means there's nothing that God cannot do. There are no enemies that can overwhelm God. And I was thinking about trying how to describe how powerful God is. And there's nothing that we can do to really describe the power of God. So I just want to take a very small example, and that is the sun that rises every morning. And every time that sun rises, every time you see the sun, just think about it, that the sun is described as being a billion hydrogen bombs going off every second. Over a billion hydrogen bombs going off every second. And God made that. In fact, God made billions of stars, and the star that we have is not particularly remarkable among them. It's just a regular star. And if that kind of power is too great to get our minds around, then think about what the sun produces. It produces solar flares continuously. And NASA tells us that one solar flare can power the entire United States for 1,000,000 years. The power that is released in one solar flare can power the United States for 1,000,000 years. That is immense, immense power. God is powerful, very, very powerful. He created and He sustains the universe. He holds it all together. And the reason that He can hold the universe together is because He is everywhere. He is omnipresent. Omnipresent means everywhere at once. God doesn't have to go anywhere because He's already there, wherever there is. The psalmist wrote in 139, verse 6, "This is too glorious, too wonderful to believe. I can never be lost to your spirit. I can never get away from my God. If I go up to heaven, you are there. If I go down to the place of the dead, you are there. If I ride the morning winds to the farthest oceans, even there your hand will guide me, your strength will support me." God is everywhere. And He is paying attention to everything. And that means He's also omniscient. Omniscient means that God knows everything. There's nothing that you can tell God He doesn't already know. You'll never hear God say something like, "I'm glad you told me. I didn't know that." It's just not going to happen because God knows everything. And so when we confess our sins to God, it's not that we're trying to inform Him. He already knows. But what we're doing is we're taking responsibility for and acknowledging our sin. We're asking Him to forgive us, and we receive His forgiveness, and we want a renewed relationship with Him. And so in verse 6, the apostle reminds us that God is omnipotent, He's omnipresent, and He's omniscient, ruling over creation. And this includes the results of the coming election. The results are not going to be a surprise to God. They never are. And as we're coming up on these weeks, I want to encourage you to read the book of Daniel. And I want you, as you read it, to look for a phrase that goes something like this: "The Most High rules the kingdom of men and will give it to whom He will." And the point is that God appoints the rulers of nations. That phrase is found in almost all of the early chapters, and actually three times in chapter 4. And what it tells us is that God is in control. And since we know that from history and so many other things, it's important that we choose to be on His side. It's important for us to be reminded that God is in control, because people who have quit attending church are not being reminded of that, and it's affecting their health. According to Barna Research, practicing Christians who have stopped attending church in recent weeks are more likely than all other practicing Christians to say they feel bored all of the time, or that they have felt insecure for at least some of the day. Not attending church affects how people think, and it's not to the good. And believers need to be reminded of the command that's given to us in the book of Hebrews to not forsake the assembling of ourselves together. We need to assemble together regularly, and all the more as you see the day appearing. The day is a reference to Jesus Christ coming again. And the Bible tells us about the signs of His coming. And we've studied some of that in the past, the fires and the smoke and the pandemics and the unrest and the displacement and economic uncertainty and the riots and the looting could be signs that Jesus Christ is coming back again soon. And it's that excites a Christian believer, that Jesus Christ might be coming back again soon. But perhaps you have not yet asked Jesus to be your Savior and Lord. And so today I'd like you to give you the opportunity to make that decision, to ask Jesus to become your Savior and Lord. And the way we do that is simply by prayer. A prayer is an act of faith. It's speaking, believing that God hears and will respond. So by faith we are praying, asking God to be our Savior and Lord. And so I'll say a phrase, and if you'd like, you join with me today and accept Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank You for making me and loving me, even when I've ignored You and gone my own way. I need You in my life, and I'm sorry for my sins. I ask You to forgive me. Thank You for dying on the cross for me, and please help me to understand it more. as much as I know how, I want to follow you from now on. Please come into my life and make me a new person inside. I accept your gift of salvation. Please help me to grow now as a Christian. In Jesus' name, amen. And if you prayed that prayer in earnest, then we have this assurance from the Word of God. Whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. And if you made that decision today, I want to invite you to send me an email at pastor@highlands.us because I'd like the opportunity to respond to you, encourage you in your walk of faith. pastor@highlands.us. Let's pray, shall we? Lord, we pray that our nation may emerge from these difficulties united as one nation under God. We pray that conspiracies of evil are exposed, and that people will awaken to see how we're being misled and manipulated. We pray wisdom, guidance, blessing, protection, and health upon our president and leaders. We pray that true justice will prevail, that there will be liberty and justice for all. We pray protection upon those who serve and protect our communities, our police, fire, and first responders. We pray provision for businesses so that they can provide for their employees, so that they can provide for their families and loved ones. We pray protection and health on our health care workers and their families and healing from every disease. And we are so thankful, Lord, that we can call upon you, our Heavenly Father, and you hear our prayer. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're going to be sharing communion this morning. So this is an opportunity for you to gather the elements so that when we partake together in a little while, you have them handy.
Sing it together in Christ alone. Hello, I'm Pastor John. Would you please pray with me? God, you spoke creation into existence. You spoke in many wonderful promises. Open our ears and our hearts and speak life over us as we celebrate communion with you and with each other today. In John 6:63, Jesus says, "The words I have spoken to you are spirit and are life." Have you ever heard any stories about people that have died and then come back to life? And they've either seen heaven, but they had a mission to complete here, or they've seen the flames of hell and they come back repenting and wanting to be saved. Well, I want to recall for us a story where Jesus speaks life and raises the dead, literally. It's the story of Jesus speaking life over a young man and bringing him back from the dead. It's found in Luke 7:11. It goes like this. Jesus went to a city called Nain, and his disciples were going along with him, accompanied by a large crowd. Now, as he approached the gate of the city, a dead man was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow, and a sizable crowd from the city was with her. When the Lord saw her, he felt compassion for her and said to her, "Do not weep." And he came up and touched the coffin, and the bearers came to a halt. And he said, "Young man, I say to you, arise." The dead man sat up and began to speak, and Jesus gave him back to his mother. You can imagine the scene. The scripture says, fear gripped them all, and they began glorifying God, saying, "A great prophet has arisen among us, and God has visited his people." Yes, he has. Jesus is God. And he walked on this earth as a man. He has visited his people. And he has compassion and power to speak life into every situation, into mine, into your situation. I don't have an "I died and I came back to life" story, but I do have an "I was dead in my trespasses and sins, and God has made me alive in Christ" testimony. Jesus met me at my point of need, and he'll meet you at yours. Listen to these words from Ephesians 2. "You were dead in your trespasses and sins, but God, being rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our transgressions, made us alive together in Christ. By grace you have been saved." Grace, an acronym, God's riches at Christ's expense. The richness of a restored relationship with God the Father at Christ's expense. My sins washed away, paid in full with his blood, his life. This Jesus God raised up again. He is alive. Have you received him and the blessings only he can give? Jesus is calling people from death to life right now. John 5:21 says, "For just as the Father raises the dead and gives them life, even so the Son gives life to whom he wishes." He's speaking life over you, offering life to you, his life in you. And this is what we celebrate in communion today. If you'll take and hold the elements, and we'll partake together. Jesus took some bread, and after a blessing, he broke it and he gave it to the disciples and he said, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us eat the bread. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and said, "Drink from it, all of you. This cup is poured out for you. It is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us drink and pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for Jesus. Thank you for your great love for us, even when we were dead in our trespasses and sins. Thank you for giving us life, your life, Jesus, Through the Holy Spirit, we live and we worship you today. We praise your name, Jesus, and pray in your beautiful name. Amen. Now I dismiss you with this benediction. Go and sin no more. The grace of God is upon you. He loves you.